So who were the armored dinosaurs? Welcome to the Natural History of Dinosaurs. My name is Benjamin Berger. I'm a paleontologist at Utah State University, teaching in the heart of Utah's dinosaur country in Vernal. In this video, we're going to review the various armored dinosaurs that belong to the Therophoria, which includes the iconic Stegosaurus and Ankylosaurus, two genera of dinosaurs that boldly developed both gigantic sizes, but also bony armor for protection from predators. All right, so what is this bony armor and how did it develop in dinosaurs? Osteoderms are bony scutes. They originate in the skin and they've been found in many dinosaurs, but also crocodilians, lizards, and many other reptiles. These bony scutes readily fossilize since they're actually made out of bone, and they're found throughout the Mesozoic and even in the Cenozoic with fossil crocodilians. Now, these osteoderms form when osteocysts, which are special bone-forming cells, activate in the ectodermal layers of a developing embryo. And since the ancestors of dinosaurs had osteoderms, their occurrence throughout the dinosauria clade is not all that surprising. These osteoderms are important for protection, and some of the early turkey-sized ornithischian dinosaurs from the early Jurassic took advantage of developing osteoderms to help cover their bodies and protect them from predators. The earliest osteoderm-covered ornithischian dinosaur known is Scutellosaurus, which was discovered in the early Jurassic Kayenta formation in Arizona. It's dated about 196 million years ago, and like other basal ornithischian dinosaurs, Scutellosaurus was about the size of a large goose, about turkey size. Now, we don't have a skull, so the skull is unknown, but the skeleton preserved with it a large number of bony scutes, or osteoderms, which in life would have covered the dinosaur in sort of scaly, bony skin. So this little dinosaur would have kind of like the skin of a crocodile along its back. Now that little dinosaur was bipedal, running around on two legs, but in about 5 million years, these early armored dinosaurs would become quadrupedal, especially as they became larger and they developed more osteoderms on their bodies. Scelidosaurus, which is known from the early Jurassic of Dorset, England, it ranged up to cow size with an estimated length of about 3.8 meters, is dated at 191 million years ago. Scelidosaurus is a really important dinosaur in the evolution of Therophoria because it's not too derived or strange or bizarre. So it can serve both as the ancestor of both the Stegosaurian and the Ankylosauria, which would split from a Scelidosaurus-like ancestor during the middle of the Jurassic period. Now, we've known about Scelidosaurus for a very long time. It was actually described by Richard Owen in 1863, and these are some of his illustrations from his early monograph on Scelidosaurus from England. Now, the most remarkable skeleton of Scelidosaurus was found in the year 2000, but it's not been formally described as it's in a private collection. The cast of the specimen is on display in St. George, Utah at the Dinosaur Discovery Site, which is the only cast in the United States of this English dinosaur on display. The skeleton exhibits these large bony osteoderms from the neck all the way down through the tail. Scelidosaurus was the first armored dinosaur to fuse the four sacral vertebrae with the ilium to form a broad, stiff lower hip that was helpful to provide the additional weight of osteoderm armor on its body. Now, the animal was fully quadrupedal, walking around on four legs. Less complete specimens of Scelidosaurus have been found in the Kayenta Formation in the American Southwest, but the best specimens come from England. Realize that during this period, the continents were still interconnected as they were slowly starting to split apart during the Cretaceous. So during the later Cretaceous, these Scelidosaurus-like dinosaurs would become isolated on the various continents as they drifted apart and started to evolve into their own trajectories throughout the rest of the Mesozoic. During the Middle Jurassic, the armored dinosaurs split into two major groups, the Stegosauria and the Ankylosauria. The Stegosauria are recognized by having big plates that run along the back of the animal and having tail horns or tail spikes. Stegosaurians also tend to have a smaller set of osteoderms that are featured along the bottom side of the neck. The Stegosauria include about 14 to 15 genera, with only a few that are well represented by nearly complete skeletons, all of which are known from the Middle to Late Jurassic, although some Stegosaurian bones have been reported in the early Cretaceous of China. The two best formations for finding Stegosaurian dinosaurs are the Middle to Late Jurassic Shikshimiao Formation in Asia and the Late Jurassic Morrison Formation in North America. The oldest, well-known Stegosaurian is Wangyangosaurus from the lower part of the Shikshimiao Formation of China. Wangyangosaurus was about the size of a cow with small plates that ran along the back of the skeleton and smaller osteoderms along the flanks of the animal. The tail had four long horns or spikes. From the Upper Shikshimiao Formation of China is the much larger Tojangosaurus, which is late Jurassic in age, and it's known from two partial skeletons. Tongjingosaurus had longer tail horns and bigger plates along the back of the animal. One of the most mysterious dinosaurs is Gigantospinosaurus from the Shikshimiao Formation. Gigantospinosaurus is really weird. It has a giant periscapular blade which extends off the shoulder of this creature. The only known skeleton of Gigantospinosaurus on display at the Zigong Dinosaur Museum in Sichuan, China. Now, no one has proposed what purpose these giant blades in the shoulder would serve in life, but we can only speculate. Recent phylogenetic trees by Suanna Maidment suggests that Gigantospinosaurus is a primitive offshoot of a Stegosaurian clade, but, you know, I just can't wait to learn more about this strange dinosaur. The next famous Stegosaurian dinosaur is Kendrosaurus, which is known from the late Jurassic of Tanzania in Africa. It too has a periscapular blade, which is not as large, and the horns extend over the posterior of the body, sort of spikes over the posterior part of the body, and then we have these small plates over the anterior of the body from the back onto the neck of the animal. Kendrosaurus was a rather small stegosaurian measuring about 4 meters in length. A nice skeleton of Kendrosaurus is on display in Berlin, Germany, which was collected during the German Tendanguru expedition of 1909. Now, during that time, Germany controlled this part of East Africa as a colony, which it lost after World War I. Recent geological work on the dinosaur-bearing Tendanguru Formation indicate that it was on the margin of a seaway called the Somali Basin, which was seismically active during the breakup of India and Africa, and it resulted in a number of tsunamis, which may explain the wealth of jumbled dinosaur bones preserved in Tanzania in these late Jurassic deposits that would have been killed by these tsunamis and broken apart and deposited very quickly and buried very quickly. All right, finally we come to the icon of the Stegosaurian, the classic dinosaur Stegosaurus, which is well known from Western North America. It's been found in Utah, Colorado, and Wyoming. It's also been found in Europe, in Portugal. Stegosaurus is well studied from multiple complete skeletons. It's a common dinosaur from the Morrison Formation, and the dinosaur is one of the largest of the Stegosaurian dinosaurs, measuring about 6.5 meters in length. Now, the tail of Stegosaurus features four horns or spikes, which Ken Carpenter has named a thaugomizer, in homage to the Far Side comic strip, which featured a caveman explaining the name of this horn structure at the end of a Stegosaurus as thaugomizer, after the late Thag Simons. And this silly comic reference has stuck around, and most workers of Stegosaurus named this feature of Stegosaurus the nystagmizer ever since then. Now, over the years, there's been a number of complete skeletons discovered all within the Morrison Formation. The first specimens were found near Denver, but some of the best Stegosaurus specimens come from Canyon City, Colorado, including the Smithsonian Roadkill specimen and the Denver Museum specimen that's on display in Denver. The Denver Museum Stegosaurus is a remarkable discovery as it provides a complete skeleton and helps us understand the arrangement of the plates along the back of the dinosaur with two rows of alternating plates. The Denver Museum specimen helped to reconstruct the neck armor that was found in the genus and likely helped protect the long neck from nipping smaller dinosaurs. This specimen took nearly a decade to prepare by the late paleontologist Donna Engard. It was airlifted out of the quarry in the mid-1990s to a place, an old abandoned fire station in Canyon City, where it was prepared for many years and eventually now is on display in Denver. Now, the Stegosaurus is not a real speedy dinosaur. These large plates may have served a role in protecting it from carnivorous dinosaurs like Allosaurus, which is very common in the Morrison Formation. Now, recent research in Stegosaurus has either split the genus into a number of different genera or argued for stratigraphic differences in the different species or genera. And most recently, people have proposed that there is maybe some sexual dimorphism with different shapes of the plates representing different sexes. Although, if true, it'd be a rare case of sexual dimorphism in dinosaurs. Now, lots of names have been erected for Stegosaurus-like specimens in the Morrison Formation, although conservatively, most are likely within one or two species of Stegosaurus, and there was a lot of variability in the morphology of the plates and the tail horns or tail spikes. Now, there's some really bizarre and strange things about Stegosaurians. First is that they have a relatively small skull, given their body size. They have reduced or lost the antiorbital fenestra. Now, the skulls are long and narrow, and the teeth are not the grinding teeth that we associate with ornithischian dinosaurs. Now, this must have meant that Stegosaurians had a strange diet, or they were using their large guts to help digest the vegetation that they were eating their food. It is strange that they did not develop chewing teeth like other ornithischian dinosaurs. All right, the next group of dinosaurs are the Ankylosauria, which is divided into two families, the Ankylosauridae, which had tail clubs, and the Nodosauridae, which lacked tail clubs. The Nodosauridae also had a large chromium process on the scapula, which would be an attachment site for a large deltoid muscle, which would be useful in digging. And the humerus is also wide and large for strong forearms. But these probably would be used for digging and very active digging. Their bodies were also covered in armor with these weird bowling ball-like heads, which are fused together with bony scales on top of them. There are four well-known notosaurids, ranging from the late Jurassic throughout the Cretaceous. The genus Mimora pelta is known from the Morrison Formation of North America. It had a more nimble skull, wide body, and fused sacral region of the hip. This small cow-sized dinosaur was slightly more advanced from the four-legged Scelidosaurus from the earlier part of the Jurassic. Another primitive ankylosaur was described from the Morrison Formation called Gargoyleosaurus, which had a different arrangement of osteoderms. Both Myliopelta and Gorgoyleosaurus are rare in the Morrison Formation, and only once you get into the Cretaceous do the ankylosaur dinosaurs become much more common. In 2013, there was a new Nodosauria dinosaur that was discovered in the early Cretaceous of Europe called Europelta. And by the late Cretaceous, the Nodosauriids had become large, tank-sized dinosaurs, such as Sauropelta with its massive neck horns and the closely related Edmontonia. Now, Ankylosauriids split off during the early Cretaceous, likely from an ancestor like Gastinoa. Gastinoa is an early Cretaceous ankylosaurid from Utah, which is found in the Cedar Mountain Formation. It had a thicker suit of armor with large horn-like osteoderms. The robust arm bones suggest strong digging muscles, which meant that this cow-sized creature could quickly bury its body and shelter from predators with its thick armor as a defense against carnivores like Utah raptor, which was living at the time of Gastinoa. Now, while it had a long row of tail horns, it actually lacked a tail club. The first tail-clubbed ankylosaurs are found during the late Cretaceous, such as the large tank-sized Panacosaurus from Mongolia and Eupeliocephalus from Canada. Both of these dinosaurs had large tail clubs. In North America, Ankylosaurus exemplifies the massive tank-like body of this group with the large bowling ball-sized tail club. Study of the tail club shows that it was a massive amalgamation of osteoderms, which served to add weight to the end of the tail. This stiff club could be swung back and forth to protect this animal from large predators. Now, the development of a tail club likely resulted from the increasing size of large predatory dinosaurs that lived at that time. So these tank-like dinosaurs, they had to deal with these big, huge, giant predators. So they would dig down and bury their bodies and rely on that thick, armored back. Now, that may not be much use if you're trying to defend yourself from a big, giant, carnivorous dinosaur like a Tyrannosaurus rex, which lived at this time. They could come in and they could flip over these ankylosaurs and dig out and bite your belly, the underbelly, which would be unprotected. So this big tail club would swing back and forth, and that would cause these large predators to think about whether they wanted to go after this creature or not. Now, endocasts of the bowling ball-like skulls of ankylosaurs show that they had convoluted nasal passages, which allow these creatures an enhanced ability to smell, and they may have allowed them to snort out sounds that would be unique and very loud, a bit like the coils that you see in a French horn. Now, during the late Cretaceous, Eupeliocephalus was a fairly common dinosaur in Canada, and many skulls are known, allowing researchers a better understanding of the population variation in the group, which is pretty rare for dinosaurs. All right, let's do a quick review. How do you tell Ankylosauria from Stegosauria? All right, some Ankylosauria have a bony tail. Ankylosauria have rounded fused skulls that look like bowling balls. Ankylosauria have many osteoderms. The Ankylosauria have spikes along the shoulder and can have them coming off the pelvis. The Stegosauria, on the other hand, have tail horns or spikes called a phagomizer. Stegosaurias have narrow skulls. The Stegosauria have spikes or plates along the back. And some Stegosaurias have these large spikes that come off their shoulders. All right, so you should now be able to compare the anatomical difference between Ankylosauria and Stegosauria and appraise the shared ancestry of the two groups with Scutellosaurus and Scelidosaurus.